Any guesses? The company is called Bitcoin. Bitcoin, which you might have heard of. So, the Bitcoin concept, I mean, and the blockchain is a way to implement Bitcoin. It is defined by something called smart contracts. And smart contracts are a programmatic way to transfer assets. Remember, information technology is about transfer of information. Smart contracts are a way of transferring value. Okay. So these were defined by a guy called Nick Szabo in 1997. And in 2009, a person whose name is believed to be Satoshi Nakamoto, he established the equivalence between validation and reward, asset under management, and the concept of connecting reward to the sweat equity. So you see, you are validating the transfer of assets, like a clerk in a bank should get a reward for this. Now, what is the asset under management? What is the asset that the bank is getting managed? That is the equity shares of the company. And Satoshi Nakamoto's genius was to make the reward same as the equity. And for this, I believe we should get the Nobel Prize in economics, not the Nobel Prize in technology. It is an amazing economic concept which connects asset under management to the reward to create a cryptocurrency called Bitcoin. So what is Bitcoin? Is it a currency? A new and efficient way to pay for goods? Is it a commodity? Something like gold or crude oil that needs to be mined using CPU power? Or is it what is known as a digital autonomous corporation, which is a self-running company? So this is the amazing new thing. It's on the block. It's called cryptocurrency, and it is based on blockchain. So let me stop for a while and check back with you. Does this make sense, what I said just now? Are you familiar with these words, assets?
Yes, sir. Stock.
Right. No, as an asset can be money also.
It can be liquid also.
It can be we heard a cotton, guar seeds, so many things traded in the market, silver. And equity is like equity share of a company. Here we have a guy who is connecting this amazing economics concept. It has been implemented using technology. That comes later. But the sheer economic concept of connecting the two is what is the main thing. And you see, we say that the Bitcoin is one kind of cryptocurrency. There are many other cryptocurrencies, like you might have heard of Dogecoin, Ether, Ethereum, Litecoin. There are millions of them. Now, there is something called blockchain, which we talked about yesterday. Now, this cryptocurrency runs on blockchain technology, and it is the most important application. Now, people will say that a blockchain can be used for health records, a blockchain can be used for educational records, the blockchain can be used for stuff like that. I do not agree with that at all. Coal. You know what is coal, right? Koila. Now, coal can be used to make naphthalene. Coal can be used for making phenol. But is that what we really value coal for? No. We value coal for lighting fires. The main reason for the value of coal is because it provides energy, not because it provides naphtha and phenol and naphthalene. Similarly, blockchain the most important application is cryptocurrency. Anything else is a diversion. I mean, I can take a challenge that whatever is done with a blockchain, which is not cryptocurrency, can be done far more easily with a relational database management system. It just doesn't require a blockchain to do something like, you know, some of the other apps people talk about. Cryptocurrency, on the other hand, or rather the storage and transfer of value, economic value, not any other value, economic value is what is best done with blockchains and their corresponding cryptocurrency. Okay, so remember, a blockchain is a way to create a unmanned, digital, distributed, autonomous corporation. It is based on powers of mathematics and economics. Okay, I'm not an economics person, so I'll restrict myself to the mathematical side of blockchain, and hopefully we'll understand how interesting it is. So any question before we jump further? Looks like the stunned. Anyway, okay, let's go. Okay, so here we are. So now let us move forward. Let us understand the, so the three questions. Is Bitcoin a currency, a commodity, or a digital autonomous corporation? It's actually all three. And underlying it all is blockchain. Let us understand the cryptographic fundamentals of a blockchain. Cryptography is a branch of mathematics which allows us to transfer, convert a string of numbers into another string of numbers. We have a number 235, I'll make it 789, using some rules. Cryptography emerged as a way to keep secrets, but now it has become very widely used. So let us look at this. A cryptographic function, what is a function? A function takes something as an input and generates something as an output. Input and output are usually alphanumeric strings, which means they are a string, a collection of alphabets and numbers. Let's look at the first function, 9 to 11. You get 9, you get 11. There are two parts in a cryptographic function. There is a rule and there is a key. In this case, our rule says add the key. So if I, and the key is 2. So the rule is x plus k and k is equal to 2. So if I give you 9, you'll get 11. If I give you 17, what will you give me? If the input is 17, what is the output? Right. So the rule is x plus k and the k is 2. Next rule is k is 2. Output is x raised to the power k. So if I give you 3, answer is 9. If I tell you 4, what's the answer?
Sixty-four.
2 raised to the power 4, right? No. 4 raised to the power 2. 16. Right. So there are two things. There's a key value and there's a function. Let's look at the third one. Input is Prithvish. I'm giving a mystery function called crypt. K is equal to 2. And I can show you the output. Can you tell me what is the mystery function?
Letters are considered like two. Two letters forward.
Right. So P becomes R. Yeah. R becomes T, and so on. Right. That's right. So that's excellent. So there is a function, and there is a key. Now, if I make it K is equal to 3 and crypt, what will the output look like? So what will P become? If K is equal to 3, what will P become? Yes.
T.
S. If K is equal to 3, then P will become QRS. Okay. So this is what is known as a cryptographic function. So there are two things. There is a rules and there's a key. And then interesting thing is the rule is always public, but the key could be either public or secret. Okay. So this is the basis of cryptographic functions. Okay. Moving forward, there can be many kinds of functions. A one-way function is it can take the input, generate an output, but cannot come back the other way. So we have a function which just adds the numbers of the which adds the digits. So 125 gives an 8, and 40706 also gives an 8. This is not nice. It's called a collision. Okay, so two inputs giving the same output is a collision. Okay, then you have something like another function, which is just converts a name into a PAN number. This is also a function. You can define it for anybody in this country who has a PAN. You can take his name and convert it into a PAN function. Okay, so you see, functions can be of many kinds. Okay, and the most important function that we look at is what is known as the SHA-256 function, which takes any string and converts it into a 256 character string. This ensures that there will never be a collision and two inputs will never give the same output. Okay, so this SHA-256 function is the heart of all that we are trying to do. Okay. Any questions on this? Am I making sense? I hope you're with me on this, because this cryptographic functions will
SHA-256. If there is a collision in that case.
So the SHA-256.
Yeah, what are you saying? SHA-256?
Yes, sir. No. I didn't understand that, sir.
It's a function. You don't understand it. It has an input, generates an output. And the output is 256 characters long. How it is generated is not for us to know right now. You need not know. Okay. Believe it. Believe okay. It that it gives you a unique number.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay.
So now let us move forward. Okay. So this SHA-256 is called a hash function. It can take any input and generate a very large number. Okay. You may not be seeing 256 characters out here, but if you write it out in binary, it will come out as 256. This is in hex. Okay. So you can take anything and convert it, any string, and convert it into a function like this, which leads us to the concept of tamper-proof messages. So if I take a message like pay rupees 2 lakh to Prithvish Mukherjee, and we calculate its hash to, you can see the number out there. Now suppose you think you're very smart, the person who's taking this message, he converts it to pay rupees 20 lakhs Prithvish Mukherjee. How will the recipient know whether the message has been hashed or not? Whether it has been tampered or not? Well, very simple. You will have to check the hash of the original and the received message. And if there is a discrepancy, you will know that the message has been hashed. You will notice this when you download software from good reputable sites. They will also give you the hash of the software that is getting downloaded, which means if somebody has put in a virus in the software, you will be able to know whether there's been a virus in the software or not, it has been tampered with or not. So having this hash of a string allows you to determine whether the string has been tampered with or not, has been changed or not. Okay. Again, don't worry about how this number is generated. Believe me, there is a function. Like we say, add to, you know, raise to the square. It is something more complicated than that. I don't want to get into that right now. And it's not important for us at this point. But let's see why this hash is important. Okay. Now comes the concept of encryption. Hashing is an irreversible process. From the output, you cannot generate the input back. Encryption is a two-way process. Okay. So it goes like this. You have an original message in clear text. Okay. It could be a message like, I'm going to Bombay tomorrow. Okay. I have shown it in red because it is, anybody can see it. Then I have two things. I have an encrypt function and I have a secret key. A secret key is a string of numbers, which I only know. So I use it to create a new string, and this is an unreadable message in cipher text. So the original message in clear text becomes an unreadable message in cipher text. Now, this unreadable message in cipher text can be brought back to clear text by using a decrypt function and the secret key. So you see, hashing is irreversible, but encryption, hashing is a one-way process. From Prithvish Mukherjee, you can get this number, but from this number, you can't get this back. But in encryption, the same principles are used, but we have two different functions, the encrypt and decrypt function, and by which we can convert a clear text into a cipher text and cipher text back to clear text. You'll be wondering, why are we doing all this? You'll see, realize very soon why this is so important in the transfer of assets. Okay, bear with me. This is the one of the fundamental things about this, how this whole thing works. Okay. So now, one reason for encryption is to ensure privacy. Okay. Now, suppose the message is, Arup will meet Bina at 2 p.m. at Victoria. This is a message which needs to be transferred from Arup to Bina without anybody getting to know of it. Okay. So what they can do, Arup will encrypt the message using a secret pass. Secret pass is a key. It's a key which is an alphanumeric string. We can also refer to it as a password. We use the word password generally. Okay. So you see, that text has now got converted to cipher text. That XYZAERTY78S and so on and so forth. Okay. Now this message can be transmitted. Nobody can understand what's going on. The recipient can use it to decrypt. So the message remains secure. But is the message really secure?
So if anybody has the knowledge of a secret pass, they can decrypt it.
And the secret pass has to be sent from Arup to Bina.
Yeah.
So just like the message can be intercepted, the secret pass can also be intercepted. And if he gets it, then the whole message is compromised. So you see, we have a problem. We have a problem in this approach. Okay. So what is now the solution to this? You know, for thousands of years, humanity has tried to figure out a way how to pass, how to transmit the secret key in a safe manner. I mean, you can read about it for hundreds and hundreds of years, right from the time of prehistoric times. People have been, kings have been trying to distribute these passwords in a secret manner. It's called the key distribution problem. Okay. Until about 30 years back, somebody found a clever way to do it. And it is called asymmetric encryption and decryption. Asymmetric. Why asymmetric? Because it uses two keys. Let's call them K2 and K1. Okay. Again, both are just strings of numbers. There's nothing, no, there's no difference between them, except both are strings of numbers. One could be ABCD 1, 2, 3, 4. Another could be PQRS 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. There's a way to do it to create them, but they are strings of numbers. Now, the interesting thing is, if you use K2 to encrypt the message, you cannot decrypt it with K2. It has to be decrypted with K1. And if you encrypt it with K1, you cannot decrypt it with K1. You have to decrypt it with K2. So there is an asymmetry. It's not symmetrical. This was symmetrical. The same key is used to encrypt and decrypt. This is asymmetrical. And this K2 and K1 are what are known as public and private keys. And they are the foundations of the entire cryptocurrency and blockchain technology. Okay. So remember, K2 and K1 are two different strings, two different collections of numbers. If you use any one to encrypt, you have to use the other one to decrypt. Okay. Any questions on this? Very key step.
Sir, what if there are three or four keys, more than that? So we can't hear you.
Me?
Yeah. Yes. Sir.
You can only, the whole thing needs two keys, a key pair. There is no need for a third and a fourth. There is no requirement.
Okay.
Okay.
Sir, one thing, that is, when there is one key, so there is a chance of like the message being compromised. But as you said, like when there is two keys, the one which is being sent is not used to decrypt. To decrypt, we have to use another one. So the other one also, the two parties will know. So like it can also be seen when the can be seen through the second key as well. Like, how is this like actually protecting? I don't understand that.
You will see it in a minute. That's why I stopped here. You will see in a minute how what a clever thing this whole thing is. Give me a minute. Next slide, we explain this. Okay. Now, privacy. Okay. Now, in this case, Arup will be sending a message to Bina, like A is sending a message to B. Okay. Now, Arup has a private key A and a public key A. Bina also has a private key A and a public key A, public key B. Bina's private key is here. Bina's public key is here. So what does, and since it is a public key, it is publicly visible. So all that Arup needs to do is to take Bina's public key and use it to encrypt. And then Bina can decrypt it with her private key. So you see, there is no way anybody can, only Bina can read the message. Anybody else, suppose a guy called Chandru, who is trying to eavesdrop on the whole process. Okay. Chandru sees Bina's public key as it was being transmitted. But Chandru cannot decrypt, because decryption can only happen with Bina's private key, and Bina's private key has not been on the road, has not been transmitted. Dolon, have you understood why it's private now? It's safe right now?
Yes, I understood. But the one thing is, like the Binance, which is the private key through which he, like she is decrypting the message and can see it. So in any way, anybody else can see that, the private key in any means?
No, no, private is private. So it's only with her. She, it will not, it will never leave her person. I mean, her machine or computer or it will never leave her at all.
Okay.
Sir, can understand. You just explain me the whole process now in this slide, only this one?
This slide, what happens is, see, Arup has a private key and a public key. Bina has a private key and a public key.
So these four keys are different, right?
Four are different. They are four different strings of numbers. Okay? Okay. Now, in this process, Arup's keys are not being used at all. Forget about them. Bina's public key, which is known to everybody in the world, it can be a part of her Facebook page. Okay. Now, if Arup wants to send a secret message to Bina, he will go to Bina's Facebook page, pick up the public key, and use it to encrypt and send the encrypted message. Only Bina has the private key. And only she can decrypt the message. All of us can see that Arup has sent an encrypted message to Bina. All of us have Bina's public key, but we cannot decrypt the message. Agreed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you see, asymmetric encryption ensures privacy. There is no way anybody can break this. It is, there are ways, but you know, that is a very, very extremely, let's not say less done, but in general, it cannot be done. Okay. So you see, this is the concept of asymmetric encryption for privacy. But privacy is not the only thing. There is another very important thing called authentication. Okay. Now let us look at this one. Now, you see, today there are many fake messages floating around. Now, Arup maybe loves Bina. So, he puts up a message floating around which says, Arup loves Bina. Now, how do you know it has come from the real Arup? Anybody can say, I can put out a message saying that, you know, Atanu sir is a cheat. Or I can say Charanpreet sir is a criminal. I can say that. People will say, hey, Prithvi sir is saying it's a great thing, but maybe I have not said it. How do you know I have said it? Okay. So what they do is, so if now Bina would like to know whether it has really been sent by Arup or not.
Sir, public key.
So what will happen is, now Arup has a public key and a private key, and he has used the public. He has used. He does not encrypt the message. He does not want privacy. He has no need for privacy. He wants to shout from the rooftop that Arup loves Bina. Okay, but how does he authenticate that Arup is saying so? So he creates a signature. A signature is nothing but another string of numbers. And he encrypts his public key with his private key to create a signature. So the signature is the encryption of the public key with the private key. So this creates a signature. Okay. Now this signature is attached.
It's unclear to me. Can you just repeat this one? The signature.
The signature, like any message when encrypted becomes encrypted, right? So in this case, the public key could be 82345. If you encrypt it with the private key, 2345 becomes 78910. Some logic? So this 78910 becomes a signature. Okay. Now, how do we know whether this is Arup's signature or not? What we can do is, we know Arup's public key. So it is there on his Facebook page. We take Arup's public key and decrypt it. And what comes out must be the same public key again. Okay. So if these two things match, it means this signature has come from Arup and not from anybody else. Nobody else could have created this signature. Because if, okay, so again, so this is a public key. Public key got encrypted with the private key to create a signature. The signature gets decrypted with the public key, and the output should be the public key itself. So if these two match, we know that the message has originated from Arup. Right?
So one question, that is, every message will have a different signature. Like first time, suppose Arup is sending this message, so this will have one signature, and second time he is sending another message, that will have a different signature.
Long as his public key remains the same, the signature remains the same.
Okay.
Suppose I am sending you letters. At the bottom, I sign with my pen. My signature remains the same. I don't change my signature in every letter. In the bank, when you sign a check, the signature remains the same, but the bank checks it each time against the specimen signature record. Okay. So you see, the signature is what is nothing but a string of numbers generated by encrypting the public key with the private key and attached to this. Okay. And it can be decrypted with the public key. And if the two things match, it means it has been signed by Arup and not by somebody pretending to be Arup. So you see, these are two things. One is authentication, other is privacy. So asymmetric encryption can be used. This is the process, two keys. It can be used for privacy. It can be used for authentication. And that is what is going to be our strategy for doing all this asset transfer. See, all this being, you know, a movement of numbers, it can be done automatically without any human intervention, which is why Bitcoin can run autonomously. Okay. So now we can build contracts without trust. Okay. How does this work? Let us consider that Bina transfers an asset. It could be a house. He's transferring an asset to Chandru. Typically, when you sell a house, you have to also show that you own the house. So Bina claims that Arup transferred this asset to Bina. So she has a clear title to transfer asset to Chandru. Chandru does not trust Bina. So Bina produces transfer contract that Arup gave to Bina. Now, this is the standard procedure. If any of you have seen your parents trying to buy or sell a flat or a house, see, this is how it happens. Okay. The builder will be giving a contract to your father saying that, you know, I am transferring the house to you. Your father will ask him, how did you get the house? So he will show another contract which says that he bought the land from somebody. And hence, I own this land. I've made this house and I'm giving it to you. Okay. All this is based on signatures. And there is a central land registry who certify all this. In our case, we have nobody. So we have to depend on our mathematics to ensure that Bina does have the asset that she is transferring to Chandru. Let's see how this thing happens. Okay, since Arup creates a contract transferring H25 to Bina. Okay, so how does this happen? So he says, there's an asset called H25. H25 maybe describes the house and stuff like that. To which is actually a string of numbers. It describes the house, the location, whatever. Okay. In front of it, he puts his own public key. And behind it, he puts it Bina's public key. So the person who transfer who's transferring his public key is put in front, and the new owner his public key is put in the back. Then what he does is he adds his signature. Signature is his own public key encrypted with the his own private key. Okay, so this he adds his signature, and then to make sure that nobody changes the thing, he adds the hash, which means somebody should not change the house number H25 to, you know, another house, smaller house, larger house, a house in the village. Okay, so he creates another hash. So this entire string of numbers becomes the contract. So you see, each of them is a string of numbers: HC1, SIGA, KPUA, H25, KPUB, all the numbers, and this entire long string of numbers forms the contract that Arup has transferred to Bina. But okay with this? Okay. Now let's move forward. Now Bina creates a similar contract C2 when he transfers it to Chandru. Now Chandru, see, it's all green. Chandru does not trust Bina. Does she really own H25? So he flags the entire contract as red, warning. He does not trust it. So Bina prefixes the first contract to the second contract, but still everything is non-trusted. Everything is non-trusted. Everything is red. So now we involve cryptography. The first question is, has Bina tampered with C1? Okay. So he checks the hash. If the hash matches, then the first contract is clear, which means Arup really sold that house to Bina. Next, which Bina is this? Maybe have you sent sold it to some other Bina? So to do that, what we do is we check the public key in the first contract with the public key in the second contract. So here we see we have the signature and the public key. With this, we generate, and if this public key is the same as the public key in the earlier contract, which means the Bina has really got this house from Arup. Hence, it is the same house which Arup sold, and it is the same Bina to whom it was sold. Hence, this contract is a clear contract, and hence Chandru has the confidence that this house that he is getting from Bina is really correct. Okay. You see, here we only used cryptography. We did not use a land registry. We did not use any third party. No witnesses, no nothing. But we simply by using mathematics, we showed that the contract is a clear contract. This is the heart of our asset transfer mechanism that is fundamental to blockchain. Okay. So when Chandru transfers to Deepa, he will again create a similar two stack contract like this, and Deepa will will apply the same process to make sure that Chandru has got a selling a real house. Interesting. I mean, if you don't understand everything right now, don't panic. Okay. I mean, this is a complex thing. I have been looking at it for many years, so I can understand it. Look at the same diagram again later on in the class. After the class, you'll understand it. But basically, we are using the cryptographic formula to ensure that we know two things. We know that there's a hash, which means that the description of the asset is not getting tampered. And secondly, the person who's transferring the asset, he has actually got it from somebody else. Okay. Is there a few chats everywhere? Okay. So you see, this is the principle of cryptographic contracts and transfer of financial assets or economic assets. I'll not say financial, economic assets. Okay. I hope I'm not boring you to death.
No, sir, it's very interesting.
Okay, let's move forward. We have some challenges. What if Bino had already sold the house to Esha? How can we stop that? Our contract validation process does not stop that. It's called double spend. Okay. And secondly, all this verification, all this number crunching, who will do all this? And why will they do all this? Why? All this, you know. So these are the two questions, the double spend and the verification. And this is where we move into the next phase of our task, the shared ledger. Okay. Establishing ownership and transfer assets. The problem with any non-material or dematerialized asset is the question of ownership. Okay. What is a dematerialized asset? It means I can have a pile of gold in my hand, or I can have a stack of currency notes. If I take that stack of currency notes and put it in the bank, it gets dematerialized. There is nothing in my hand anymore. But it is there. It's on my account, even though I don't have a hand. Now, Arup can write a check to Bina without having money in the bank. Or can write two checks of rupees 1,000. He has only 1,000 rupees in the bank, but he writes two checks. Hello? Raskochi. Okay. So, you know, establishing ownership of a non-physical asset is a challenge. And that is where the whole blockchain stuff comes in again. Now, typically, in any dematerialized situation, there's a central agency. Could be a bank. Could be a share depository. You have NSDL, which has a depository of all equity shares in the country. Or you can have a land registry office, which has a record of all land that is held by owner people. And this central agency, okay, keeps track of who's moving money to whom. So if the initial balance in a bank is Arup has 1,000, Bina has 2,000, Chandru 1,500, Deepa 200, and Esha 4,000. If Arup transfers 600 to Bina, that's a valid transaction. Bina transfers 15 to Chandru, that's a valid transaction. Chandru transferring 2,500 to Deepa is an invalid transaction because he does not have that money in the bank as yet. Okay. So there is a central agency called the bank, which allows or does not allow a transaction to get through. Okay. So that is how we operate. That is how we work like. That is the basis of all banking operations. Now we come to a scenario where we have the distributed ledger. There is no one central agency. So there are three people, and they could be anonymous people, and each of them has a copy of the ledger. So this ledger is called the blockchain. And on this blockchain, we have information regarding who has how much money. Okay. We'll see a little later that it is not stored by name. So everyone can keep a copy of the ledger. all copies are updated simultaneously. Yes, it's a huge process, but it works. And anyone can verify any transaction. Okay, not everybody has to maintain the ledger. There are some people who will maintain the ledger and some people who will use the ledger. It's fine, not a problem. Why will some people maintain the ledger? We'll see the answer later on. But currently, if there are some people maintaining the ledger, it's fine. Now you see, same thing happens. Arup transfers 6 and Bina will go through. So some transactions will be allowed and some will disallowed. But in this case, the ledger was only with the bank. In this case, the ledger is with everyone. It's public. Okay? And this is the how it starts. Now, don't get panicky with this. This is how transactions are validated. So when there is a transaction, everybody does this calculation to see whether the transaction is correct or not. Okay. So we check whether, and in this case, they see whether the input, the credit to the account is more than the debit. So if the amount of money flowing into your account is more than the money flowing out, then it is a valid transaction. Very simple. You cannot be spending more money that you have already got. Okay. So these are called unspent transaction outputs. These are called you can think of each of these green arrows as money coming into the account. And then what happens is, with this green arrow, we are creating an outlet. And so what happens is, Arup transfers 600 to Bina, which means 800 came in, 600 went to Bina, and 200 was sent back to Arup, which means Bina has got 600. And this initial input is now marked as invalid. It has become white. If you notice the top, from green, it has become white. So the green inputs are correct inputs. The whites are used up inputs. They cannot be used again. Okay. So you see, using this,
sir, I did not understand this.
You see, on the left. So on the left, you see these green arrows. Each of them represents the transfer of money towards people. Okay. So Arup has got 800, Chandru has got 700, Bina has got 1500, Isha has got 1000. Okay. So this is the initial state of the ledger. At some point in time, Arup transfers 600 to Bina. So his input, he had got 800 from somebody. We don't care where it came from. He is transferring 600 to Bina and the other 200 is going back to him. Okay. So now what happens is that first green arrow is now no more useful anymore. It has been consumed and a new set of green arrows have appeared. So this is the state of the ledger after the Arup has transferred to Bina. Okay. So, and you can walk this through. Some of the transfers are valid. And here you see an invalid transfer. When Chandru transfers 25 to Deepa, it says that the inputs do not match. Okay. Inputs do not match the output. So hence this transaction is stopped. So Chandru's transfer to Deepa is an invalid transaction, whereas the earlier two were valid transactions. Okay. So when can a transaction not be used? If it does not belong to you, obviously. If the money has been sent to Arup and Bina is trying to spend that money, it will not be worth it. It's like that house you're being sold. And of course, the other thing is you're creating a fake transaction which doesn't exist. So in either case, the transaction will not be used. So you see, some transaction marked as invalid. Now suppose somebody double spends, okay? So it tries to spend money twice. Of course, it will be stopped. It will be stopped because obviously he cannot, the number of inputs will not match. The amount of money flowing into his account will not match the amount of money he's paying out now, which means he's double spending. So this will be stopped. Now comes a difficult point. Suppose Arup has friends who agree to take a copy of his corrupt ledger and declare this is a new ledger. Now, I'm saying I'm putting in a copy of a fake transaction. Now, obviously, the blockchain software will not accept it, but I can tamper with the software on my machine. I'll force it to accept it. But this transaction will not be accepted by the other members of the network. They will see it right away. So I start a collusion. I call them on the phone. I tell them, look, brother, I'm putting in a fake transaction. You please accept it. Now, this is where the trouble comes in. There are thousands and thousands of people who are validating these transactions. How many will I talk to and convince? Well, if I can convince a group of people, then I get another blockchain, which is known as a fork of the blockchain, and which is a little fraudulent blockchain. But the trouble is, most people will not be members of this fraudulent blockchain. They will be members of the good blockchain, which is why the fraudulent blockchain will not work very well. It's like saying, look, boss, I'm trying to create some counterfeit Indian rupee notes. It's a fake note, but at least let's you and me, we agree to use it. Theek hai, you are my friend, you agree to use it. Your friend also agrees to use it. So three of us can use this currency note, but the larger number of people will not touch this currency note because they see it's a fake. Then it is of no value. If three of us are using a fake currency note, then that has no value. Similarly, unless sufficient number of people agree to this fake transaction, that transaction has no value. So if you can convince 51% or more people to agree to the transaction, then you can, you know, put in a fake transaction and double spend. So this is a very real problem. And this is, I mean, getting 51% people in the whole world to agree to your thing is not easy. And that is why from 2009 to 2021 now, there has never been a fake transaction in the Bitcoin blockchain. Never, never, never. Okay? Because it's so rugged. There are so many people involved, you really cannot convince everybody to agree to your point of view. Did I make sense out there? It's like, you know, think of it as a you are printing fake currency notes in your room. I mean, I'm trying to give it to you. You say no, it's a fake note. Throw it away. So I convince my wife to accept the note. Then I convince my son to accept the note. Then me, my wife, and my son, we have this note and we accept it. But most of you don't accept this note. Is this note of any value? No. But if I can convince a lot of you to agree to accept this note, then this note gets value. That's so difficult. I've talked to so many people and convinced or threatened people to, or frightened people to accept this note. And that is the power of the blockchain network. It is resistant. Because anybody can see straight away that this is a fake transaction. You're trying to double spend. Okay? Sounds nice?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good, good, good. Okay. Let's move forward. So a network has what are known as full nodes and light nodes. Full nodes are software which does all this verification and validation. And the light nodes are people like us, you know, who only use the coin to make transactions. They don't do the verification. So they have a smaller version of the software. Now the question is, why will these four people who are verifying and transactions, why will they do all this? We'll see that in a minute, okay? But think of this is a network. Many people on the network, there are a group of people who are called full nodes, which means that their software can validate transactions. The rest of us have wallets which store and transfer currency only. Okay. Now, what is a wallet? A wallet is not a piece of hardware. It is not a piece of software. It is not a database. A wallet is simply a pair of numbers, the public key and the private key, that can be stored anywhere, even on a piece of paper. Yes, you can have a paper wallet. Or if you have fantastic memory, you can remember it in your head. It's not possible. Huge number. It would be Shakuntala, they would remember these numbers. Okay. The huge 16-digit, 18-digit numbers. But remember, a wallet is nothing but a pair of numbers, the private key and the public key. The public key is your bank account number where people can send money. And the private key is your internet banking password that allows transfer money out of your bank account. So the public key is obviously public. You want to send me bitcoins, you have my public key address, public address. But if I have to send money to you, I have to use my private key. Okay. So remember, a wallet is nothing but a pair of numbers. So don't try to, buy a hardware wallet, or this wallet, that wallet. Okay. If you can, if there's a way to create a paper wallet, just print it out and keep it safe. That's it. Okay. That's a wallet. And that is what these people on the edge have. These edge people have wallets. Now, sometimes we have a little better wallet, a software wallet, but basically all that they do is they have the two numbers written inside. How comes the verification process? So you see, on the left-hand side, we have a whole bunch of unverified transactions. Okay. And we have a bunch of people who are the full nodes. These people, these blue, green people. Okay. They are looking at all these.
Sir, one question I have before moving forward over here, you said about the wallet, and also about the transaction. So the transaction, the money or the cash which is getting transacted, what is it? Is it the cash or if someone sells something or someone buys something, what is that currency through which everything is happening? Suppose if I want to buy, say, a chocolate in a store, so how will I actually transact, or what is the transaction, the currency over here, which is actually happening through all these things?
That's the Bitcoin. Okay.
That is the Bitcoin.
So suppose you want to go to a store to buy chocolates. Okay. Okay. What do? You open up your a Bheem or a PhonePe or your Paytm software, and you transfer 100 rupees from your bank to the chocolate shop owner's bank. Okay?
Yes.
100 rupees. Okay?
Yes.
So, you don't see the money, right? It's just that, your account goes down and his account goes up.
Yes.
Similarly here, in this case, you will transfer bitcoins. So
only bitcoins come. Okay.
This is the Bitcoin. So point is, the asset that is getting transferred is the Bitcoin or any cryptocurrency coin.
Okay.
It could be Ethereum coin, it could be Dogecoin, Litecoin, depending on which currency you are transferring. Here?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this is the verification process. So if I am transferring 10 Bitcoins to you, somebody has to certify that I really had 10 Bitcoins to give you. So these are the verification nodes. Okay. These people, the middle people in the center, who have a copy of the ledger, and they are the ones who are creating these, verifying this. Now, what happens is, the verifier, he assembles so there are many, many transactions happening simultaneously. He takes 60, 70, 80 of them, verifies their full thing up, down, karke, whether he got it or not, entire complicated process, and he creates a block. He creates a block of three valid transactions. Now there are four verification people. Each has created one block. Which of this block will be the next block? That is a very important point, because on the right you see the blockchain. The blockchain consists of blocks of validated transactions. The blockchain is a set of verified valid transactions which cannot be changed. So far we have got two blocks. Now we have to put in a third block. Now there are four people who are verifying this transactions. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now which of these four blocks will be stored as block number 236? Because anybody can verify. You can verify, I can verify, all of us can verify. Now, which verified block will be accepted? This is a scenario which is very similar. Now, let us think of a situation that validator, there are two validators. He sees Arup paying Bina first and then double spending by paying Chandru. But validator two numbers see Arup paying Chandru first and then double spending by paying Bina. So validator A number one, validator number one thinks that the Bina transaction is correct and the Chandru transaction is false. Whereas the second validator thinks that Arup Chandru transaction is correct and the Bina transaction is false. Who is correct? Who should the money go to? Go to Bina or Chandru? Okay, this is a problem. Same problem happening here. So, you know, which block should be accepted first? For this, we have what is known as a proof of work. Proof of work is a puzzle to be solved, a mathematical puzzle to be solved. So there are four people who have got four validated transactions or blocks. So four validators have created four blocks. One block will be accepted. So you have to solve a puzzle. And whoever solves the puzzle first, his block is allowed to come in to the blockchain. Okay. So it's like saying, I'm asking all of you to do the validation. Now, I will accept only one person as the first validated person. How do you decide that? So I make all of you run 1 kilometer. Whoever runs 1 kilometer comes back earliest, I will accept his answer. Same as that, the proof of work happens. And at the end of it, whoever wins the race, his stuff is placed here. And he gets a reward. Why, as I keep asking, why will people do all this validation verification? Why will you be using your CPU power and time to do all this? Because now you get your reward. If your validated block gets accepted, you get the reward. And the reward is not low. Today, you get a reward of 12.5 Bitcoins, and each Bitcoin is worth about $37,000. Huge reward you get. And that is the motivation that people have to do this validation work and hoping to get that reward. If you go back to this slide out here, these four people in the middle, they are the ones who are working the validation network, and they are the ones who are getting rewards. And we on the edge, we only have wallets, we don't get mining rewards. So these are the people who are creating new Bitcoins as a reward for doing the validation for the rest of us. Going back to the original analogy of the bank, the clerks in the bank are sweating to get to move our assets. And whenever they do their job properly, they get a piece of the asset, which is some money. Okay? And this money is not rupees, it is shares in the bank. Okay, so this is
two questions I have. First is why someone will double spend? Like why they will spend their money double?
Oh, that's very easy. I have got only 1,000 rupees. Okay, I want to buy. Okay, I have 100 rupees. I want to buy two chocolates. I go to one chocolate shop and give 100 rupees, and I go to another shop, I give 100 rupees. I can't buy two chocolates with 100 rupees, but I pretend I have 200 rupees. That's a double spend.
I didn't understand. Can you repeat this thing?
No, suppose I make a phone call. Okay, I make a
Okay.
phone call to the first chocolate store. I says, okay, I'm giving you 100 bucks. Send me a chocolate. Then I
Okay.
call up the second fellow. I'm giving you 100 bucks. Send me a chocolate. So I end up with two chocolates. Okay, and I'm using the same currency, same note twice. I can't do it. I don't have that money. Somebody has to stop up, say, stop, you can't do that. You cannot give me 100 bucks. You cannot say I'm giving 100 bucks. That's a fake transaction. That's a double.
So if it's the value of it, if it's the value of the chocolate, and I need to.
No, value is 100 rupees, na? How can I buy two chocolates for 100 rupees each by giving only 100 rupees? Think of it. You have only
Okay,
100 rupees.
I'm only spending 100 rupees. Okay, now I understand.
You only have 100 rupees. You have
Okay, now
nothing else. In your pocket, you have 100 rupees only.
I
Okay? Or
understand.
in your bank, you have only 100 rupees. But you still want to buy two chocolates, 200 rupees each. You can't
Okay.
do that. That's double spend.
Okay. So in that case, only one will be accepted.
Will be accepted. And so which one? Which
Yeah,
one? So
that is which one.
so that's so, so there's one guy who's validating. He says that the first chocolate wala should get the money, and the other says the second wala will get the money because you told him first, or I heard you first. Okay, so that is why we have to do all this. And the person who is doing all this, why will he do all this validation process?
To get
Because he will get a
more.
reward. Okay.
But another
Here
thing
I
is,
have one question, that is, well, who is giving that reward?
is giving?
Bitcoin.
A new transaction is getting created. Okay, is a reward. There is, see, all other transactions were based on an input. This is known as a coin-based transaction. It does not the input only an output favoring the winner. This is a mathematical construct. If you go back to this contract, okay. If you look at here is a contract. It says it has H25 has come from A to B. This is a transaction contract. Now, in our case, it will be H25 and KPUB only, which means it is a special kind of transaction which does not need an input but generates an output.
Yes.
So, coin-based transaction, it has no input, only output, and this adds value to the economy in general and the wallet of the winner so that he can use it in subsequent transactions. He can now use this somewhere else because he is a miner. He has
Okay.
got a new tran he's got some extra 15 bitcoins in his pocket right now, in his wallet.
So, sir, is it like there are many people who will be mining on a specific transaction, suppose, and whoever does it first will get the reward?
Yes. That is why you need a very fast computer, a lot of energy to do it.
Okay. So,
All of us
sir.
can do it. All of us can do it. But unfortunately, you will find with if you do it with your laptop is so slow that you will never be able to catch up with somebody else. They'll do it before you do.
So that means just to do one transaction, if suppose thousands of people does it and only one person gets the reward, so thousands of people is actually spending the resources. So a lot of resources is getting wasted, and that's why it is said like it consumes a lot of resources.
Correct, and that is why this proof of work is a very energy intensive process. So, which is why the Ethereum blockchain is moving to something called proof of stake rule, which does not use energy at all. The Bitcoin blockchain is a very energy intensive blockchain. It is like all of you are running 5 kilometers every day, but only one of you are getting the prize. Okay, which is a waste. Others are, just getting tired. Okay, this is called the proof of work logic. The Ethereum blockchain, which is why going forward, Ethereum is possibly going to be a far more useful cryptocurrency. The Ethereum blockchain, they also began with proof of work, but they are migrating to a proof of stake concept, which does not require this energy.
Okay, and to solve that puzzles, like it is totally solved by mathematical application, like who will get it?
Yes, it's totally mathematical. Basically, you have to keep looking for a number that begins with a certain number of zeros in front. So you keep generating a number, another number, another number, until you get a number which has certain number of zeros in front, which is not easy to do.
Okay.
Yeah. So here's got the reward. So the mining process works like this.
But there are limited amount of cryptocurrencies, like Bitcoin is limited.
Because only so many can come. Na. Initially, earlier, every time the reward was 50 Bitcoins. Then it became 25 Bitcoins. Now it is 12.5 Bitcoins. Then it becomes 6.25 Bitcoins. And after a while, you will not get any more Bitcoins, any left. So you will not get any more new Bitcoins. You can only exchange Bitcoins, whatever you have. It's like gold. You dig gold today, you dig gold tomorrow. At some point, the gold runs out on the earth. And then you can only exchange whatever gold you have. So Bitcoins will not get over. New Bitcoins will not come into the economy. But whatever Bitcoins I have, their value will go up.
And so how this Bitcoin is created, like this coin, this Bitcoin is created in, like how it is being created?
In somebody's ledger it appears. In your ledger you suddenly find, my initial asset was 10 Bitcoins, now it has become 12 Bitcoins. So there is nothing physical. In your account ledger, in your wallet, you'll suddenly find an extra Bitcoin. That is a Coinbase reward transaction. If you have been able to solve this problem before others. Puzzling.
But sir, if it is not physical, then why it will get like it will like it won't be there anymore? Like it is like it can be generated for infinite times since it is not physical.
No, you cannot, because moment you cannot, you have to follow the rules to generate it. And if you break the rules, they are not it's like a fake transaction. The rules everybody has to agree. I cannot suddenly say I've got 5 Bitcoins in my wallet. That's a fake transaction which will be rejected by the network. Suppose in your bank, you suddenly claim that I have 1,000 rupees in my bank. Bank will say, buzz off. Are you nuts? There's no 1,000 rupees in the bank. Same, if I suddenly say my wallet has 20 Bitcoins, the network will say, no, you don't. You have only 10 Bitcoins. So my wallet will become, what is known as a forked wallet, has no value. It's like saying, I've printed a currency note at home. I have 1,000,000 rupees right now. So you say, you laugh at it. Joke hai kya? These are not real notes. So in fact, if you work on the Ethereum blockchain, there are multiple Ethereum blockchains, of which one is the formal blockchain and the others are test blockchains, which have no value. They follow the same rules, same logic, same technology, everything is same, but it has no value because those Ethereum coins are not accepted in the real blockchain. So while learning how to write blockchain programs, you can use those coins. Okay. You get it free of cost. People will give it to you. It's like Monopoly board game. Your company gives you, your game designer gives you some currency, you play with that currency.
Sir, one thing I don't understand still now, it's why this validation requires so much of power consumption. Like
because,
even if I'm learning,
there's an algorithm, na. You have to generate a number. You have to generate a number of a certain with so many zeros in front, which means the number has to be below a certain number. So you try it once, doesn't work. Again, try. You keep on trying until you get a number which has sufficient number of zeros.
Just how much time it requires to generate?
Huge. Not easy at all.
give me an example, like in days or months.
No, it depends on how fast your computer is. If you're a fast computer, it's approximately 10 minutes it takes for a fast computer. Okay. But if you use my laptop, somebody else will get it before I do. The fastest computers today take about 10 to 12 minutes to create that is the speed at which new blocks get added.
Sir, I may be asking a dumb question, but people who are watching movies or playing games, that's also power consumption. Then what difference it makes, like for cryptocurrency mining and these other activities through a computer? Why it is said that cryptocurrency mining takes a lot of power consumption than this?
We'll come to that later. After the class, we'll discuss this. Let me finish.
Okay, sir.
So you see, this mining process, it begins with a pool of unvalidated transactions, which is all here. So I have sent money to you, you have sent money, so all it's there. So the miner is collecting all these transactions, validating them, and putting it in the block. And then he gets reward, and this moves forward. This is how the mining process moves forward. So this blockchain, the shared ledger, okay? So this is the blockchain. So what is a blockchain? The blockchain is a ledger. What's a ledger? It is a set of, it's like a file. You know, it's like a, you know, one file, a second file, a third file, fourth file getting chained one behind the other. And you cannot, and the same file is available with everybody all across the world. Whoever is running a full node, he has this this collection of files, okay? And these files have to be in sync with each other. If you change anything in this file, the entire chain of files will be marked as invalid through the hash. So you can't change anything out here. If you change any number in this file, then the entire hash will go for a toss and nobody will accept this file as a valid file anymore. So that is why it cannot be changed. Okay. And the size of this file is pretty large. It's about 350 gigabytes now. And if you are running a network, you have to have, if you're running a full node, you need to have 350 gigabytes on your disk. Plus, of course, the CPU power to manage it. Now, this can be pruned, compressed, otherwise compacted. But it's estimated even if Bitcoin exceeds Visa card transactions, scalability is not an issue. Technology can handle this size of chain. Okay. So I think I'll stop here because the next part is, you know, a little complicated. Let me go through it. So I'll just bypass this, the actual coding part, and come to some very interesting things. You can, you know, put in a code. For example, the ability to validate a signature is through a piece of code which is running on the full node software. It's using a language called the script language, the Bitcoin protocol. Okay. Now, here we have the Bitcoin is the first cryptocurrency. It has a very primitive language which only checks for true and false, whether a transaction is valid or not. Answer is only true or false. But other blockchains based on Ethereum, they can have a much more complicated functionality, which means you can have multiple signatures to release an asset, a certain date before which a payment cannot be made. A payment can be made only if, you know, external conditions are met. For example, if price of oil goes below this, price of gold goes above this, only then will a transaction go through. So you can create a complicated set of release rules out here, which makes it very, very interesting as a way of transferring value, which is not possible in Bitcoin. Bitcoin is very simple. It only, you know, if you own the money, you can spend it. That's a simple rule, yes or no. But in Ethereum and other blockchains, you can have very complicated rules. And using this, you can do very interesting things. A car can be made to start when the purchaser presents his public key and if mortgage payments have been made. Otherwise, the car will not start. Else, banker's public key can be used to start and take the car away. Okay. Escrow accounts, automatic lotteries. After death of owner, heirs can automatically access assets. Okay, so all these things are possible by using programmable currency, which means the currency can be programmed and many kind of complex logic is being used. But the best application of this technology is in the stock and securities market. The blockchain can be more efficiently and accurately open to track the exchange of stocks. Currently, our money is stored in banks and our stocks are with the share depositories. NSDL and CDSL are the two depositories in this country that we have. Okay, and of course, banks, we have many. Cryptocurrency is making banks irrelevant. And the same technology can be used to make our NSDL and CDSL also irrelevant, because you can move instruments like, you know, share equity shares and debentures and bonds. It's the same process. Okay, you can track their movement very easily. And of course, in the US, they are moving towards this technology. I think very soon they will have the entire New York Stock Exchange will be moving towards blockchain technology. But they'll not use Bitcoin. They'll use blockchain, and they will use what is known as the stock market instruments, things like equity shares and so on. So as I said, you know, blockchain, the real good application is for the transfer of financial assets. Currency, commodity, shares, debentures. This is the right thing where you do not need a central agency to manage the ledger. So this brings us to the end of my talk. Happy to answer questions.
Thank you, sir. And if any one of you have any question, you may ask.
I had deferred one question. I will come back to it.
But sir, I have one question. That is, what you said, like the Bitcoin is a very efficient way to for the financial transaction, right? At present, the financial transaction, whether through be Paytm or Bheem Pay or whatever, it is on the basis of the rupees, that is currency I am having at the bank, which is in either in rupees or in dollars. But in Bitcoin, that and 1 rupee, like $1, is equivalent to suppose 100 rupees or 70 rupees. So in Bitcoin, like if I have Bitcoin over here, that valuation of Bitcoin will be same as the US, or like the US Bitcoin will be more expensive or than my Bitcoin. Is it like this?
Bitcoin has a universal value. Whether in India or whether in US, Bitcoin has a universal value. And of course, very volatile. The rupee dollar rate is around 70 rupees to a dollar. It's very stable, around 70, 71, 72. But Bitcoins, they are $37,000 for a Bitcoin. Okay, $37,000 for a Bitcoin. And whether you own, see, there is no geography. If you own a Bitcoin, where is the Bitcoin? Bitcoin is in your wallet. The wallet is nothing but a 18-digit number. Nobody knows who controls the 18-digit number, whether it is Dolon Bishash or whether it's Prithish Mukherjee. Only person who can control this 18-digit number is the person who knows the private key, the other 18-digit number. So if Dolon Vishash has her 18 other private key, then she can spend the money. So there is no national identity, there is no geographic, nothing. It is just two numbers. And if I can steal your private key from you, I have your money. It's like if I know your internet banking account password, I can transfer your money out. Am I clear? So the Bitcoin is owned not by a person, but by an 18-digit number called the public key. Strange, isn't it? Have I lost you? Hello?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Hello, sorry. Am I on?
You are not.
Hello?
So you see, did you hear what I said? The Bitcoin that you own, there is nothing called Dolon or there's nothing called Prithvish. The Bitcoin is owned by a wallet, and the wallet's identification is an 8 number.
Yes. No, actually, what I was asking that is, if we start using Bitcoin to purchase and buy everything, so previously, suppose if somebody has to buy something from USA, so they have to buy it in dollars, which would cost an Indian a lot more than somebody who is from US. So if everybody transacts through Bitcoin, so the amount of money, like suppose that foreign car would cost me as much as a person who is in America, right? So
in terms of bitcoins.
So in that case, the government might, like US government might think that we are losing out, maybe we are not getting the more money. That, there can be that conflict if that happens. Is there anything like that happens?
No, understand that when you buy a car, the US government doesn't get the money. The money goes to the car manufacturers. Okay.
Yes.
So the US government should have really nothing to say about this. And we don't have some taxes. That's all.
So if the car manufacturer is from USA,
he doesn't care whether he's getting Bitcoins. No? And if he is comfortable receiving Bitcoins, he's okay. He says, no, I'll not take Bitcoins in dollars, so you have to pay in dollars. It's his choice.
Does this cryptocurrency affect the economy directly?
It's a long story. I mean, I cannot answer this question in one shot. Okay. I mean, it undermines the authority of the central banking system. That's what you can say. Whether it is good or bad, that's a long story. But for example, in India, let's take an example. We have to give 130 crore people injections, COVID injections. Now, each injection costs about 400 rupees, right? So how many crores can somebody quickly calculate? How many crores is required? 130 crores into 400. Lots of money. Say 10,000 crores rupees, or more. 30,000 crore rupees. Okay. Now, Madam Finance Minister doesn't have this money. So what can she do? She can ask Reserve Bank to print notes. She print notes worth 30,000 crore rupees, and then he uses those notes to pay Poonawalla and Covaxin to get the vaccines out. Do you think that is good or bad? You have to ask Sayantani ma'am what that means. If the Reserve Bank 30,000 crore rupees worth of currency note and gives it to Poonawalla, you can figure out it will not be good for the economy. Okay?
Yes, sir. Inflation will happen later.
Which means the central... Now, if you have Bitcoins, nobody can print currency notes. Which means the authority of the central government is weakened. Now, Modi ji might say, I want to hell with inflation. I want to get a vaccines to people. So no chapao. Now the point is, you may disagree with him. Not allowed. Okay. And you see countries like Zimbabwe, Venezuela, their currencies have become worthless because they were kept printing notes and giving out to people. Oh, you have to pay salary, print notes and give it to people. You want salary, take notes. So Venezuela and Zimbabwe have become completely bankrupt because of this. Okay. So this is why the cryptocurrency, it erodes the ability of the central banks, which is why central banks are trying to stop it. But they can't. it's an idea whose time has come. Like in IT, cannot be stopped. Okay. Similarly, cryptocurrency cannot be stopped. They cannot stop it. I mean, what they're doing is they are telling banks you cannot deal with them, but Supreme Court has struck down this process. Okay.
How value is calculated of Bitcoin?
Value is calculated by between buyer and seller. How is the value of a share market stock is determined? I mean, if I it's a market pricing mechanism. If there are more buyers than sellers, the value goes up. If there are more sellers than buyers, the value goes down. Okay, as simple as that. There is nobody to fix. For example, who has set the India rupee dollar rate at around 70 rupees? Do you think it is Mr. Modi or is it Joe Biden? No, none of them. It is the market. The market thinks that, you know, and the market is number of people, not one person. Okay. So again, this is a very economic term. The market sets the value of between the dollar and the rupee. Similarly, the market sets the value between Bitcoin and the dollar. And then, of course, it follows Bitcoin to rupee also follows from that. So nobody's setting the price.
Sir, as Ethereum blockchain is different, in the case of Ethereum blockchain, can you use Bitcoin or we have to use that Ethereum coin only?
It's only Ether coin. You can't use coin cannot move from one blockchain to another. It simply be rejected.
So what is better, Ethereum coin or Bitcoin?
Long story. Ethereum can be used for many other activities. Ethereum has I personally feel Ethereum is better because it is a more programmable coin. It can be used for many other things. Bitcoin is a very narrow thing, but very popular. Bitcoin popularity is incredible.
So there are usage of different cryptocurrencies. Like there are limits that we can use this for certain purpose or for buying certain products or not.
No, it's not you can buy certain products. The kind of task, for example, I'm telling you, so Ethereum can be used for multi-signature wallets. So before spending, see, a Bitcoin, if I have one wallet, I can send it to you straight away. But in Ethereum, you can plan it in such a way that only me and Sayanthani ma'am together can send it to you. So this kind of intelligence can be built into the Ethereum blockchain. That is not possible in the Bitcoin blockchain. Or I can say, on the Ethereum blockchain, I can code it in such a manner that this Ethereum coin can only be spent in a grocery shop and not in a liquor store. I can code it that way. If I want, I can code it that way. So that kind of smart coding is possible. So the government can give subsidy in Ethereum, saying that it can only be spent if to buy rice and not to buy liquor. That is not possible. Bitcoin is not possible. I mean, the normal vanilla Ethereum will not work like this, but we can enhance the Ethereum blockchain with these kinds of things. Smart coding. Good, I think I've exceeded my time. So those who want to leave, you can leave. I'm here to answer more questions. Thank you very much for listening. So people who want to leave, fair enough, you have other things to do. But I think I left a couple of, if somebody has some outstanding questions, they can stay back. I'm here for some more time.
Anyone have any question?
Yes. Sir, that question which I have asked regarding the consumption of power, can you just explain?
Okay, consumption of power. Yes. Well, you see, when you are watching movies, that is you take it for granted that you'll be spending some energy, but the amount of useless energy that is being spent in validating Bitcoin is a kind of irritating. People find it really, really inefficient. Okay. Why should you be using so much energy to validate Bitcoins? I mean, you know, the thing is, it's a waste of resources, natural resources. It causes, it's a matter of, you know, perception. You know, for example, if you're sitting in an AC room, you can say AC is fine, you know, it's comfortable. I can say, why are you sitting in AC room? You are using resources, you know, burning electricity. Well, it's a matter of perception. Sitting in an AC room is not illegal. So I can't, you know, put you in jail for that. But I can feel, yeah, this guy is bad. He's using, you know, so many people are sitting in the sun. This fellow is enjoying AC. It's a matter of perception.
Okay, sir. So there is no like hard and fast rule that cryptocurrency mining takes lots of consumption.
It is expensive. No, you know, riding a Mercedes car. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, it consumes much more petrol. But you say, so what? I have money, I'll spend it. Tomorrow I can.
Yeah. Okay. Get it.
It's not illegal to ride a Mercedes car.
But in that case, printing a note or coins, that is also quite expensive. That also requires money.
That is requires money. But honestly and frankly, Bitcoin takes a lot of energy, which is why the Ethereum blockchain is, you know, they have decided from version 2, they'll move to a new technology called proof of stake, where the consumption will be far less. It's always good to find better things. Na? For example, you know, old cars are very energy guzzling. So people think of using better cars, which are more energy efficient. So it's always better to move something new. But because so many people use Bitcoin, it's so popular, you can't drop it overnight. It's very valuable right now.
Sir, I have a question, sir. Hello. Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Sir, how can we buy cryptocurrency, sir? Like Bitcoin, Ethereum, are there different sites? Or it's like the same website, we can buy different cryptocurrencies.
You have to sign up. For example, let's think of it. How do you buy stocks? You sign up with a broker. Say, best one of the easiest brokers is Zerodha.com. So you create an account in Zerodha.com. They'll do some KYC for you. Passport, dekhao, ye dekhao, wo dekhao. And then you will transfer rupees from your bank to their bank account first, and then you will use that money to buy Tata Steel shares, say Hindustan Lever shares. Okay, so this is how you transact in equity shares, and that goes through a company like Zerodha, and there are many such companies are there. I don't know, HDFC. Everybody has one. Similarly, there are other companies. For example, WazirPay. Another company called BitBNS. Okay, so you sign up with them. They'll do your KYC, and then you can transfer money from your bank account to their account. So you have 1,000 rupees or 50,000 rupee credit with them. Then you use that money to buy Ethereum. You can use that money to buy Bitcoin. You can use that money to buy Dogecoin, and then you can, you know, sell Dogecoin and buy Ethereum. You think that, you know, Dogecoin will rise faster than Ethereum. So you sell Dogecoin and buy Ethereum. Then you sell Ethereum and buy Bitcoin. So all the trading that people do, you know, you Tata Steel share chhodke, Hindustan Lever share kharido. So you can do that. So there are companies called, you know, these are called cryptocurrency. Crypto exchanges.
And it is similar like shares. It is similar like a share market, right, sir?
A share market. It's like a share market. So when you want to sell, you have to give a sell order, and your sell order will be matched with somebody's buy order, and the transaction will happen there.
And sir, can we buy it in any form of currency, or specifically we should buy it in dollars?
No. You have to. In India, you can buy in rupees.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Isme, the government of India is creating some jhamela. They did not ban Bitcoin, but they said no banks can transact with these people. So then these people went to Supreme Court. Supreme Court said, nahin, yeah, as long as the cryptocurrency is allowed in India, for example, you cannot legally buy, say, opium or a drug. Okay, you cannot sell on the streets because the government says it is illegal. But nobody has said that, you know, Bitcoin is illegal. So if it is not illegal, I can buy it. So why are you saying you banks cannot send money to them? So both jhamela hua hai. Currently, the status is you can buy and you can send money from your bank account using NEFT to the exchange's bank account. And from then, you can buy any cryptocurrency. And if you want to take your money back, it will come back the same way as it happens in any stock market.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, is coding essential for using blockchain?
Now, if you want to just sell and buy cryptocurrency, no coding is required.
Okay.
It's like buying shares. You want to buy, you need to have some basic operation, you know, log in, log out of a exchange, you know, NEFT karo for KYC or do some upload picture, upload your Aadhaar card, PAN card, but no coding. But if you want to write, you know, for example, at one point in time, I created my own coin, IndieCoin, and me and my son were the only people using that coin. Okay. For that, I had to write code. So every morning I'll send him one coin and evening he'll send that coin back to me because our network was only two people. Only two people in the network, me and my son. Okay. So after a while it got very boring actually. Exchanging Indie coin with my son, so we dropped the idea.
So is that private blockchain? Creating own coin?
On Ethereum blockchain. You can create your own coins. That's the nice thing about Ethereum blockchain. Oh. On the Ethereum blockchain, the main thing is Ether, but you can create your own, you know, you can create or no coin there on it, not a problem.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So for that, you do some coding. Or no coin ke liye coding chahiye.
So to win that reward, like a lot of to solve that, whoever will solve it first, like he or she will get the reward. So there are a lot of mathematics and as well as coding is required, or only it is done by mathematics.
You don't do any coding for that. See, there is that not required. The coding is already available. You can download the software. It's called the say the Bitcoin full node. Okay, you download that software on your laptop, and then you start the software running. Okay, it will try to solve it on its own. Now, obviously, you win the race because your laptop will not be a millionth as fast as some other people's laptop. That's all. But you don't do any coding. No coding.
Okay.
Do you like coding, Dolan?
No, actually, I'm learning coding and I'm kind of liking it. But yeah, I think I need to learn a lot more. I'm just learning Python.
Which is it? But this is not the same thing, coding. But you know, it's coding. But you know, it's complex coding. It's a very complex software. No? So you know, it will take you a little time to learn it.
Okay.
So if you run out of questions, then we can stop.
Anyone? Any more questions? Thank you, sir, for sharing such an insightful information with us. And thank you, everyone, for joining the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. See you soon, hopefully.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Not in this. Bye-bye.